Good evening, everyone. Wow, good evening, everyone. I'm Father Bill Leese. I'm the Vice President for Mission Engagement and Church Affairs. I want to welcome you to this evening. I'm honored to be with you tonight to bring you greetings from Father John Jenkins, our president, and to help welcome all of you to this very important conversation. We are so grateful that you're here, and I want to thank and welcome in a particular way our own bishop, Kevin Rhodes, and Cardinal Onaiyekan, who will be our opening speaker tonight. The dignity of the human person. What could be a more important topic for us? The concept rooted in our creation in the image and likeness of God proclaims that human life is sacred and that that sanctity is at the very foundation of our moral vision for society. Indeed, respect for the human person, as Gaudium et Spes puts it, proceeds by way of respect for the principle that everyone should look upon one's neighbor without exception as another self, above all bearing in mind that neighbor's life and the meaning and the means necessary for living it with dignity. The aim of this conference is to renew the discussion around the concept of human dignity by recovering its philosophical and theological foundations. And as such, we will surely uncover a deeper understanding of true human freedom. Again, to all of you, welcome to this important conference, and thank you for being here. I now have the pleasure of introducing the convener of this conference, the director of the Institute for Church Life, Dr. John Cavadini. Please help me to not only welcome, but to thank John, too, for all his efforts in advancing this important discussion, not just with his conference, but in all that he does. Friends, John Cavadini.
Thanks, Father Bill. Hi, everyone. Nice to see everyone. And I, as Bill said, I'm director of the Institute for Church Life, and on behalf of the Institute, and also on behalf of our Office of Human Dignity and Life Initiatives, Jess Keating, director, I would like to welcome everyone this evening. So, friends, what is human dignity? As central as that concept is for Catholic social teaching, the meaning of the phrase has come under question. Recent articles in the field of philosophy, both in scholarly journals and in popular ones, have questioned whether the concept really has any meaning at all, whether it is simply a cipher to fit the interests of the person or institution using it, and so whether ultimately it is a useful concept at all. From this point of view, it has been called a useless concept. On the other hand, one could say that the concept is so useful because one can use it to defend even diametrically opposed positions on controversial issues. That is, in a way, it's too useful. And therefore, not only has no meaning at all, but is a stupid concept that should not be used by educated people. That's not my word, that's a word that was used in one of these articles. In an article in First Things in May of 2011, Marianne Glendon called attention to this problem. The problem, as she put it, of the unbearable lightness of dignity. She cited the way in which the concept of human dignity was in its heyday after the Second World War, in the face of the grossest and most obvious violations of it, and that it was used to ground the famous Declaration of the Rights of Man, and it found its way into renewed constitutions of Germany and other post-war European states as the foundation for human rights. In its success was perhaps contained the germ of its decline, because everyone was anxious to have it as a guarantee of new rights they wanted to claim as time went on, some of them conflicting with each other, as I've already mentioned. The criticisms of the concept of human dignity as useless and or stupid arose on the heels of such developments. Professor Glendon called for a renewed investigation into the meaning of the concept of dignity, and our conference is intended to respond to her call. We hope to contribute towards clarifying the philosophical and theological foundations of the concept of human dignity, but at the same time, not accept as the terms of successful clarification only the discovery of a definition. Along with philosophical and theological clarification of the concept, we also hope to show what realities are, we could say, the coordinates of human dignity. What do you lose when you declare the term useless? Whatever is lost, in a way, plots the coordinates of the concept of human dignity and begins to help us understand the usefulness, indeed the irreplaceable and irreducible value of the idea of human dignity, as we begin to understand what society would look like if the language of human dignity were partly or entirely eliminated from public discourse because of its alleged uselessness. We believe that this will ultimately involve a vision of human dignity anchored in the logic of attentiveness to weakness and to vulnerability. We hope thereby to make a contribution to the theology and philosophy of human dignity and thereby to a deeper understanding of Catholic social teaching. So friend, that's our theme. And now it's my pleasure and my honor to be able to introduce our speaker for this evening, Cardinal John Onaiyekan, Archbishop of Abuja, capital of Nigeria, was born on January 29th, 1944 in Kaba, Nigeria. And in 1963, he entered, St. Peter and Paul Major Seminary in Bodija. 2 years later, in 1965, he went to Rome to complete his formation at the Pontifical Urban College of Propaganda Fide. And in that same year, 1969, he was ordained a priest on August 3rd. He earned a license in sacred theology at the Pontifical Biblical Institute and a doctorate in biblical theology at the Pontifical Urban University. In 1977, he became vice rector, and in 1979, rector of Saints Peter and Paul Major Seminary. In 1980, he was appointed a member for 5 years of the International Theological Commission and also of the International Commission for Catholic Methodist Dialogue. When he was ordained a bishop by Pope John Paul II, on January 6, 1983, he became the youngest bishop in Nigeria at a mere 38 years old. On October 20, 1984, he was named Bishop of Ilorin, and 6 years later, on July 7, 1990, coadjutor bishop of Abuja, to which he succeeded as bishop on September 28, 1992. He welcomed John Paul II on his apostolic visit to Nigeria in 1998 and played a major role among the African bishops and in organizations for interreligious and ecumenical dialogue. He was president of the Association of the Episcopal Conferences of Anglophone West Africa, and from 2004 to 2007 served as president of the Symposium of Episcopal Conferences of Africa and Madagascar. CCAM. A member of the Nigeria Interreligious Council, he served as co-president of the African Council of Religious Leaders and president of the Christian Association of Nigeria, of which he had been vice president from 96 to 2003. He subsequently participated in the Synod on the New Evangelization in October 2012. Cardinal Onaiyekan is well known for his tireless work for peace in Nigeria. He has received decorations at home and abroad, including the Pax Christi International Prize on October 31st, 2012 in Brussels. He was also a candidate for the Nobel Peace Prize, together with a Muslim exponent of Nigeria, with whom he promoted a series of initiatives against fundamentalism. It may be that as distinguished as all of these honors are, Archbishop Onaiyekan, who was created and proclaimed cardinal by Benedict XVI November 24th, 2012, is most well known and respected among all the Nigerian people of any religion for a steadfast, forthright, consistent, and utterly courageous denunciation of corruption in government, fearlessly naming names when they had to be named. I do not think it's an exaggeration to say that he is, for all of these reasons, the most beloved spiritual leader, which is in a way to say the most beloved leader in his country and beyond. This evening, his lecture on the topic of human dignity, human race to human family, will serve at once as the opening keynote to our conference and as the spring 2016 Human Dignity Lecture. And I'm sure you'll all join me in welcoming Cardinal Onaiyekan to the podium.
I must say, I did recognize myself in some of the things that John Cardinal said. Some of them I was rather surprised. But since he's a good friend and an honest person, I believe he was not telling lies. Thank you very much, John. I wish to thank Professor John Cardinal, an old friend, for graciously inviting me to be part of this important conference on human dignity in the world of today. I thank him for giving me the honor of presenting this opening lecture. I thank him also for making it possible for me to give an African voice to the discourse. I hope that my contribution will not just be about Africa, but more about how an African sees the discussion of human dignity in our world today. I hope this will complement, perhaps balance, or even challenge many of the wonderful academic lectures that we shall be listening to in the next few days. I hope, however, that it will not obscure, or certainly I don't intend to disorganize your work. I was told to send in advance my text, so I sent it waiting to get a reply. Say, thank you very much, Your Eminence. Actually, your paper has no relevance to our discussion, but you are still free to come. I would have taken it in good spirits. Instead, he's now allowing me to give my paper, and I will give it. I was practically just read it since I prepared it, I must say carefully, in the crucible of the hard work that a normal, busy archbishop has, especially over the period of Easter. Thank you very much, John, and may God bless your work. State of the question. The American Declaration of Independence declares that the issues about which we are talking now, namely human dignity, is self-evident. I'm now hearing that this is now being seriously queried, not only by some strange, wild-thinking individuals, but also by serious professors of philosophy and theology. We have always believed that there is some general human consensus on these matters, and that this is in itself a valid proof of its truth. But we have also seen so much failure to live up to these ideals. While this in itself does not invalidate the ideals, we cannot ignore the realities around us. Be that as it may, we need to keep before us a clear vision of where we ought to be, so as to guide our attitudes and behaviors. The challenge is how to encourage those ideals and to discourage the inevitable betrayals of such ideals. It is in line with this general observation that I approach the topic in three parts. First, the ideals of human dignity. Secondly, the tragic history of human failures in this regard. And thirdly, the way forward for the human family, the ideals. I believe it can be generally admitted that there is a general consensus among human beings, I say general consensus among human beings, that the human person has a dignity that is well above that of all animals, including the most powerful, fastest, and biggest. This is what we mean by self-evident. Here we are talking of what is generally called the common sense of the proverbial ordinary man or woman on the street. There are surely certain common values of justice, of truth, and of dignity. This we find in every civilization from the beginning of human history until now and all over the world. For example, in the African traditional culture in which I grew up, it is clear that a human being does not behave like an irrational animal, nor should he be treated as one. From the religious perspective, it is also generally agreed. Love of God and love of neighbor are two main religious principles valid not only for Christians, but for other human beings as well. Recently, a group of Muslim scholars and leaders from all over the world presented such a case in a carefully worded document which they tagged Common Word Among Us, a document that did not receive the wide publicity that, in my opinion, it deserves. We can see similar values among other great religions like Hinduism, Buddhism, etc. For the Judeo-Christian revelation, the ideal of human dignity is clearly spelled out right from the beginning of our sacred texts. The creation story in the book of Genesis, whatever may be said about its scientific value, certainly contains very deep theological, spiritual, and even philosophical truths. In this story, the human person is presented as the apex of God's creation. After every other thing was in place, God created the human pair as the crown of his work. Furthermore, the man he created was in his own image and likeness. This means that there is something in the human being that gives him the dignity that even associates him with God himself. This added extra in humans is generally called the soul or the spirit, an element that is spiritual and which, unlike the material human body, does not die. This is why we dare not deny human beings certain prerogatives which God himself has given to him. There is no stronger basis for fundamental human rights than the fact that every human being has some kind of absolute value, which is his or hers from creation, and which is not open to negotiation. The same creation story offers very deep and significant reflection about relationship between the sexes, and that's an argument that is very much debated today. After the creation of man, God did not find any companion worthy of him among his many animals and other creatures. So he created a woman from the body of the man, to the great admiration and joy of the man. This is indeed bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. And so the man, created by God, is male and female, and both in the equal dignity of the image and likeness of God. Thus, any efforts to eliminate the radical equality and complementarity of the sexes in the name of gender equality can only do damage to the image and likeness of God in the human person. Still from the same creation story, there's another truth relevant to our discussion, namely that humanity began from one family of one man and one woman, Adam and Eve. The growth of human families into tribes and nations and peoples is seen as a normal growth which does not invalidate the original idea of one family. It rather shows how, no matter who you are, how you are, and where you are, we all belong together. If we are of one family, we have a basic equality. We are all related. We are like distant brothers and cousins, no matter how distant. The Israelite faith, despite the doctrine of the special election of Israel, which we find all across the Hebrew Bible, the fact was always there that God continues to care for all human beings. Nobody is out of the range of God's care and concern. The laws of Israel, in some parts, spell this out in very clear terms, where the care of strangers, the needy, and the handicapped is considered as a primary obligation of the law of Moses. Thus, just a quick example, in the book of Leviticus, we read, "You must not curse the dumb because he cannot reply back to you, nor put an obstacle in the blind man's way. He will not see the obstacle. But you must fear your God, for I am the Lord." Furthermore, in the book of Deuteronomy, we read, "You are not to exploit the hired servant who is poor and destitute, whether he is one of your brothers or a stranger who lives in your midst. You must pay him his wage each day, not allowing the sun to set before you do, for he is poor and is anxious for it. Otherwise, he may appeal to Yahweh against you, and it will be a sin for you." I come from a country where right now there's a grave problem of government lagging behind in the payment of salaries. And we keep reminding government, this is a grave sin. Especially when the big men are getting their salaries and allowances on time. "You must not pervert justice in dealing with a stranger or an orphan, nor take a widow's garment in pledge. Remember that you were a slave in Egypt, and that Yahweh, your God, redeemed you from there." We Christians believe that in the person of Jesus, God has not only done something completely new in our human history, but has in fact made himself present in the person of Jesus himself. We see in this the highest elevation in human nature. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. That God shared our humanity means that the human nature is elevated to the highest possible level. Jesus Christ, therefore, becomes a reference point of all humanity and human dignity discourse, whether he is so recognized or believed in or not. Our Christian doctrine further teaches us that Jesus will come again to judge the living and the dead, and that at the end of time, there will be an eschatological recapitulation of everything in Christ. Those who have such ideas about Jesus, God made man, cannot but have a high view of the dignity which God has conferred on human beings and reconfirmed through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. For after all, as Second Vatican Council II puts it, man is the only creature God willed for himself. Gaudium et spes. I come from a country where our 170 million population is equally shared between Christians and Muslims. So the Muslim perspective is very important for me. Although I'm not an expert on Islam, my Muslim friends tell me that in this area, there are many common grounds between Christianity and Islam. They tell me that Islam also professes the common origin of all human beings in Adam and Eve. It also stresses the high degree of the dignity of the human person who is considered as the vice regent of God here on earth. These are important elements of the Islamic faith, and whatever we share in this regard, we hold as valuable foundations for our common efforts to sustain human dignity all over the world. By the way, let me add too, I have referred to the biblical story about the creation of Eve from the very nature of Adam himself. And I draw here an argument of the equality of sexes. I have met Muslims who, while they have the same story about Adam and Eve, arrive at a different conclusion. Namely, that it is stupid to say that women are equal to men. They were taken away from the man. And you cannot say they are equal. And this is why they justify polygamy. One man can marry many women, but one woman cannot marry many men. For them, it is logical. I disagree with them, and many good Muslims don't agree with that position. That is good to know, that even though we have the same story, we could look at them from different perspectives. Humanity is in gradual progress. Recent developments in the history of humanity seem to suggest that we are making progress in the recognition of human dignity. The modern principle of fundamental human rights of all human beings is relatively new and a sign of human progress. Some rights are inalienable. That is, they are not conferred on the individual by any other human being or institution, and cannot be taken away by any human being or institutions, including governments, no matter how powerful. These include the rights to life, to freedom of conscience and of belief, etc. The Human Rights Charter of the United Nations is a great modern achievement of the human spirit, which indicates that, at least on some issues, the human community is making progress. The institution of the United Nations organizations, which tries to promote and even at times to enforce these rights, is also a step in the right direction. These structures are imperfect, no doubt, but they are nevertheless very useful. I think it is good to recognize those areas where we seem to be making progress, comparing humanity now with what it was 500 years ago. I've decided to cast a look at the reality of how human beings have treated human dignity down through history. Despite such high-sounding principles of human dignity, the history of humanity is full of breaches and failures in adequate recognition of human dignity. There are many classical crimes against humanity. This is a modern term, crimes against humanity, in the history of the world. These breaches are so often so tenacious and sometimes so endemic that we often don't even recognize them for what they are, namely crimes against humanity. Let us take a few examples. Wars. There are the wars of all kinds in which people consider other human beings as enemies to be killed, oppressed, and in every way subjugated. How many human beings have been sacrificed on the altar of wars? The history of humanity is very often written in blood and violence. Worst of all, these crimes are often eulogized, idealized, and practically considered as heroic enterprises. And so, the great heroes of nations often are warmongers, who have been responsible for a lot of destruction of other people. Such heroes are hailed and given great honor. Statues, monuments, squares, and other public places are named after people who have engaged in violent war in the belief that they served the nation. Such horrendous killings in wars are directed not only against the presumed enemy, it also implicates citizens and fellow nationals who are drafted into battles to fight for the nation. A visit to any of the many vast war cemeteries all over the world, and I've seen many of them in Europe, keeps one wondering how many human lives have been sacrificed on the dubious altar of patriotism. And we continue to feed the young and the coming generations with such tragic lies for their admiration and emulation. In the words of the popular peace song, we may ask, how many deaths will it take till we know that too many people have died? The sad irony is that even now, there's little effort to reverse this kind of history. It is no wonder, therefore, that there are people who think that the greatest way of showing valor is to engage in wars that kill other human beings. Another classical historic war against humanity is slavery, which seems to be as old as humanity and still a plague in our contemporary world in many shapes and forms. Slavery means that human beings are considered as property and goods, articles for sale and purchase, to be used as if they are not of the same value with other persons. The history of humanity is full of cases of slavery and enslavement. For long, it was taken for granted that there are those who are free and there are those who are slaves. The most clamorous examples, of course, of these crimes against humanity are the famous slave trades, of which the African peoples have been the most victimized. Perhaps the most vicious and notorious was the transatlantic slave trade from Africa to the Americas, North and South. The significant presence of persons of African descent in these regions is a vivid reminder of what was nothing less than a human tragedy, whose negative impact is still to be effectively healed. Recent events, even here in the United States of America, where a half-black man now occupies the White House, there are still a lot of issues of race to resolve. The good news is that the problem is at least acknowledged and steps are being taken in the right direction, even though many might rightly argue that these steps are often slow and perhaps insufficient. There was another extensive slave trade from Africa, often not mentioned, namely this trade from Africa to the Middle East by the Arabs, Muslim Arabs, about which little is generally mentioned. It is no less condemnable and damaging to the human dignity of the black man, and we must not allow it to be forgotten by history. What about the modern history about which the media has recently been drawing long overdue attention? The plague of trafficking in human persons in all its forms has become a global epidemic. This takes the forms of forced or poorly paid labor, domestic servitude of vulnerable foreigners, sexual exploitation of women and girls by criminal gangs, etc. I have been personally involved, with not much success, unfortunately, in the shameful phenomenon of Nigerian women forced into prostitution on the streets of Europe. Personally involved, I mean, in trying to stop it, not as part of the perpetrators. Many have been deceived into undertaking such journeys with false promises of gainful employment overseas. Many others freely offer themselves at great cost and risk to themselves in a naive search for a better life in Europe, only to end up in a worse and often hopeless situation. These are cases where human dignity has become a matter for commercial negotiation and practical denial. Situations like this are a terrible affront to human dignity and call for the concerted attention and effort from well-meaning persons and institutions across the globe. On this human trafficking, it is interesting and sad that the majority of those who find themselves trafficked actually trafficked themselves. Many of our young people, they sell all they have, sometimes sell their family land, and take the route for Europe, for what they consider a better world. They feel they are ashamed to go back home because they have sold everything. It's worse than the Atlantic slave trade, because this time it is the young men who are carrying themselves out into slavery, and women too. Now, there's another issue from the history which I call for, I want of a better word, continental genocide. At some point after the so-called voyages of discovery by Europeans of previously to them unknown territories in distant continents, I said, discovery is on the part of the Europeans. People come and discovered my people, but my people have been there all along. What are you discovering? But they call it discovery because they didn't know about our presence. Probably at the same time, we discovered them too. So it's a process of mutual discovery. After these so-called voyages of discovery, a process of massive movements of territorial occupation was undertaken over many centuries, especially to places in the Americas and Australia. Thus, by gradual pressures, and often by brute force of arms, the original inhabitants of the newly discovered lands were pushed away and eliminated to make room for the new settlers. In many cases, it was a matter of what we now call genocide, the destruction of whole peoples and nations. Sometimes, for example, among the South America Incas, great civilizations were completely wiped out. Some efforts were made in Southern Africa to do the same, culminating in the apartheid regime, but the project, thank be to God, eventually failed due to the resilience and resistance of the African peoples who refused to be thrown out of their ancestral lands. But cases like those of the Hurons of North America, the Incas of South America, and the nameless Aboriginal black fellows of Australia, we don't even know the name of their tribes, were not so lucky. These sad pages of the history of violation of human dignity cannot be buried beneath the heaps of biased stories as told by the victors and conquerors. We must today continue to rise up to condemn and seek to change any situations where human beings are being slaughtered or left to die en masse because they are from the wrong side of the world or because they are too powerless to defend themselves. Anything to the contrary could amount to being complicit in the destruction of human dignity because it amounts to the denial of the human person himself. Another example of historic crime against humanity and against human dignity, I speak here about colonialism. In a similar vein as an African, I cannot but mention the historical institution of colonialism, especially as it affected the continent of Africa. One cannot deny, of course, that colonialism did bring some positive impact into Africa and to other colonized lands. Most nations in Africa today owe their national origins and boundaries to the colonial enterprise. Good example is my country, Nigeria. which would not have existed as it is today were it not for colonialism. A lot of modern social services like education, health, and general infrastructure date back in their beginnings to the colonial era. For many of us, perhaps the greatest positive heritage of colonialism for our people is that it somehow facilitated the planting and early growth of the Christian faith in our lands. We must add here, however, immediately, at least as far as Nigeria is concerned, that this was by no means a priority concern of the colonial administration. In fact, they did not hesitate to obstruct or even forbid the work of Christian missionaries whenever and wherever they saw it as a hindrance to their colonial objectives. Having considered these positive elements of colonialism, the fact remains that it was a forceful subjugation of peoples, civilizations, and territories, all in the interest of foreign lands. In fact, the territories were even called possessions of the colonial powers. This had serious negative impact on how much respect was given to the people who were subjects of foreign monarchs. Africa now has many seemingly intractable problems, many of them of our own making, but many social and political challenges we face today are a carryover from the colonial experience. The post-independence failures. And one of those carryover is our post-independence experience. It is now over 50 years since the independence in most countries of Africa. At the end of the colonial era, in the 1960s, there were high hopes all over the continent that the wind of change blowing over Africa would usher in an era of freedom, peace, development, and prosperity. My generation grew up with these hopes. Looking back now, unfortunately, we have to sadly admit that our hopes have largely been unrealized and in many cases practically killed. Bad government, military and civilian dictatorships, corruption, bad leadership have turned much of our continent into a showcase of shame. The negative impact of this on the human dignity of the African population is tragic. Rampant poverty, with its attendant consequence of disease, ignorance, and social disarray, has made a mockery of our esteemed native African values and culture. Our contact and interaction with our erstwhile colonial masters and with the rest of the modern world has not always yielded positive, fruitful results. These were matters which engaged the attention of the two sessions of the Synod of Bishops for Africa in 1994 and in 2007. We thank God that in recent years we have started to see some signs, feeble signs, of socio-political improvement in some quarters. It is on such signs that we are now building our hopes for a better future for human dignity in our continent of Africa. Besides the issues raised above, we can also say that humanity has engaged in all kinds of discrimination on the basis of simple differences. Sometimes difference in the color of the skin, racial attributes, social status, all these can become basis for categorizing people as inferior or superior human beings. In all these cases, we can say that we have not yet actually changed our bad habits. Wars are still raging in many parts of the world. Modern slavery is now a matter of great concern about which we hear, see, and read in the mass media. Discriminations go on not only between nations and races, but also within nations and within the same group of peoples. Let me talk about religion. From the religious point of view, one would have thought that all the beautiful holy injunctions of the holy books would have been sufficient to guide humanity in the right direction. Unfortunately, however, the reality is often different. human beings don't often do the right thing, even if they know it. That is why many of the issues raised above, which are condemned by the law of God, continue to be part and parcel of our human experience. There is an insidious and negative impact of religion in this regard, when people tend to put God over and against man, and thereby finds excuse for denying human dignity on the ground that God must be respected and worshipped. It is as if there is a competition between God and his human creatures for respect and dignity. We still see this all the time. People will say, human rights, yes, but God's right first, by which they mean human rights must step aside so that God's rights can be affirmed. But that means there's a wrong sense of what do you mean by God's rights. After all, human beings are God's own loved creations. It is as if there is competition between God and us. How many holy wars have we not seen in history where people take up arms and claim they are fighting in the name of God? And in these so-called holy wars, human beings are destroyed. Saint Pope John Paul II has rightly observed that it is blasphemy to kill in the name of God under any circumstance. This is a far cry, surely, from the days when popes and men of God exhorted Christian knights to go on armed crusades to reconquer the holy lands from the infidels. Thus, many wars have been and are still being justified on the basis of a jihad for God's sake, or on the flimsy principles of a just war. Volumes have been written on the just war theory, with grounds that are getting less and less tenable in the circumstances of our contemporary world. The very cautious position of the Catechism of the Catholic Church on this matter deserves every attention. We have also had cases where human beings are sacrificed for religious purposes in a misguided intention to please or to appease God. Generally, the victims are taken from among people of low regard, like slaves and strangers. But at times, serious crises may call for the sacrifice of a high-level victim. There are examples in the traditional histories of some of our Nigerian peoples where the king had to offer up his most beloved daughter in sacrifice for the salvation of the nation. Father John is from Ida. I have an example from Ida, Inikwi in Ida, and we in Yoruba land, we have the case of Moremi in Ife. Ancient Israel prescribed capital punishment for many religious infringements, but unlike many of their pagan neighbors, human sacrifice to God was roundly forbidden. The story of Abraham and Isaac is a strong way of pushing this lesson. In Christianity, the execution of Jesus and the Passion, which we have only 1 week ago celebrated, is believed to be a self-immolation of Christ to his Father for our salvation. Since then, there can be no more case of human sacrifice. It is a sad fact that a lot of discrimination has been perpetrated on the basis of faith and belief. For a long time in humanity, a non-believer is a second-class citizen or no citizen at all. Sometimes the lot of non-believers is even worse. Many people have lost their lives because they did not follow the common understanding of how to worship God. Many heretics were in times past burnt at the stakes. Even today, the law of death for apostasy is still in force in some Muslim nations, especially Pakistan. Going back to Judeo-Christian scriptures, even the concept of Israel as a beloved chosen people of God sometimes became understood in terms of God's people against others, who are presumably not God's people. Is this not the drama playing itself out even today in the Middle East, in the precarious status of Palestinian Arabs, both Christians and Muslims, in the land of Israel. I stress, Palestinian Arabs are both Christians and Muslims. Thus, we have situations where religion itself, instead of being part of the solution to the problem, is evoked as the cause of the problem. Unfortunately, even today, we still have to find a way of getting humanity out of this way of thinking. Our contemporary reality shows that we still have a long way to go. We still have wars in which human beings are sacrificed to political and ideological gods. Discrimination persists on all kinds of counts for religious, racial, or political reasons. There's great fear of the other, and consequently the rejection of others in the different forms of extreme nationalism. Is this not why the world, even today, is unable to deal with the drama of migrants who feel obliged to leave their homes to seek refuge elsewhere? We are still in a world that has not yet reconciled itself with the fact that every human being has equal basic value. Last part, seeking a better future. Right now, a lot of people are not without reason. A lot of people, and not without reason, have a great fear of the future. The recent strong discussions about climate change show that unless something serious is done, we may end up destroying our planet and ourselves with it. This has been brought out most forcefully by Pope Francis in his recent groundbreaking and earth-shaking best-selling document, the encyclical Laudato Si. And I hear there is a conference on Laudato Si in these premises. Already a good chunk of our common home, to use the expression of Pope Francis, has been rendered uninhabitable, and other parts are fast being turned into a rubbish dump. The future is bleak. Nuclear weapons of global annihilation. On an unequally serious note, there is the huge pile of weapons of mass destruction, whether nuclear, chemical, or other kinds, which many nations have stupidly piled up. The nuclear nations claim they are not going to use these weapons. Yet, they spend huge sums of money, energy, and ingenuity producing and piling them up. All that is required is a madman, not necessarily a North Korean, or a technical mystic, which may not be from Iran, and the whole planet can go up in flames. We can now truly talk of weapons of global annihilation. This is why we are all genuinely concerned and worried about the very continued existence of these weapons in whosoever hands. It's good news to hear recently, yesterday, that Obama called a big meeting of some world leaders on nuclear weapons to start thinking about, can we dismantle them? I hope it is a serious and sincere project. My president came too, even though we don't have nuclear weapons in Nigeria. But since we are the biggest African country, we shall at least sit at the table. That's about it. Anyway, we'll keep watching. We hear a lot about sanctions and resolutions against certain nations seeking to possess nuclear arms. Most nations, like including my own, sincerely support non-proliferation of nuclear weapons. But we need to admit the fact that those who themselves have huge stockpiles of such weapons do not have the moral right to tell others not to have them. The logical and moral solution would be to undertake a complete dismantling of such weapons from the face of our planet. Only a nuclear-free world has a good chance of being safe and secure for all of us. While we talk of the danger of nuclear weapons, we cannot forget the non-nuclear weapons, which continue to kill and destroy lives and properties. Even the so-called small arms, it's a very funny name, small arms, whether it is small because of the weight or the length of the gun, we call them small arms. These cause great human damage and suffering. They kill, small though they are. we have still a long way to go. Thus, the vast positive possibilities of modern science and technology capable of creating a better future are still to be realized. This better future will come depending on human decision of for good or for evil. This entails, among other things, seeking and emphasizing the lot of good things and values that we all have in common. Unfortunately, we generally tend to define ourselves in terms of our differences and of who or what we are not. If we only took more note of who and what we have in common, we would certainly realize that these are the most important aspects of our lives. A short reflection on globalization. There is much talk about globalization, which is bringing us all together into a global village or even into a global living room. This is a process which many people believe is inexorable. We cannot stop it. But how it ends will depend on our human choices, individually and collectively. There is no longer any excuse to consider people in distant lands as being aliens to us. There is nowhere anymore that is out of reach with modern means of transport and communication. The whole of humanity is now living one experience of modern life. That in itself is a great positive development in human history. But that can also be a problem because, in addition to the positive gains of globalization, we are also witnessing the globalization of indifference and of violence and many other crimes against humanity, such as the ones we have already spoken about. This situation calls for great vigilance and for finding even more effective ways to defend the dignity, both locally and internationally. The human family. In fact, it can be said that for the first time in human history, it is now possible for humanity to become one human family. Differences will always be there, but we need to recognize these differences as varieties to be celebrated in the spirit of unity and diversity. It should be clear that we need not all be the same, but this can happen if we respect one another, respect differences, accept them, and welcome them. If we want to be welcomed by others, we should also welcome them across different aspects of our lives, nationalities, races, creeds, and religions, and so forth. When the human race finally becomes a human family, we will begin to realize that we belong to one another and that we are all at least cousins, if not brothers and sisters. Those of us who believe in God, who is Father of all the human creatures, will find this quite congenial. Indeed, it will seem that the only guarantee for human beings to live like a family is if they recognize their common origin and a common creator who is also Father of his creatures. For the Christian, this is carried further by our faith in Jesus, the only begotten Son of God. In him, we see ourselves as co-heirs and sons adopted by the Father as we get incorporated into Jesus, his Son. But even those who do not believe in Jesus do often regard God as Father. In my traditional culture, the Yoruba people and many other Africans readily call God Father, and we are all his children. Only recently, in the Wednesday audience, Pope Francis did make the very simple but very important statement that we are all children of God. It's a very simple statement, but if we really take it seriously, it means even the terrorist is a child of God. And if we see him as a child of God, the way we deal with him will probably be different. Maybe probably why the same Pope recently said that terrorism can only be best addressed by weapons of love, a statement that is being talked about now, even in my country, Nigeria. In conclusion, in the midst of our global fears and anxieties, we must make sure that our world not only survives, but also thrives. But this will happen only if we are ready for a fundamental change in our general attitude to our planet and all its inhabitants. All those who deny human dignity will need to explain to us how the world can find its way towards peace and harmony without the necessary attitudinal change. The onus of proof, therefore, does not lie with those of us who maintain human dignity as self-evident, but rather on those who, for whatever reasons, hold that there is no such thing as human dignity. The matter is more than a philosophical discussion. It is a matter of life and death for the individual and a matter for the future of our human race. There is a handwriting on the wall warning us that we can no longer afford to continue running world affairs with an attitude of business as usual. If we do not build a human family, we will end up as a human mob, all set to destroy ourselves and our world. The positive option is definitely possible and, to me, self-evident. One may, in fairness, ask, where is the church in all this? That would be a question for another paper. But for now, suffice to refer to the teaching of the Second Vatican Council, which states that the church is a sacrament, that is, a sign and an instrument of the unity of God with humanity and of human beings among themselves. This means that the church is supposed to be a sign of what our human community ought to be and an instrument for bringing about such a reconciled human family. The entire church, family of God on mission on earth, in all its components of leadership and followership, must be doing and seen to be doing this if she is to be true to her mission. You have been very kind and patient listening to me. Thank you very much.
Cardinal, thank you very much for this wonderful talk and from coming halfway around the world to give it to us. We need some advice here. One genocide that has not been mentioned is the one that's occurring in this country, the genocide against the unborn. This rivals in numbers any of the genocides of the 20th century. As we start this conference on human dignity, how is it that we articulate in this discussion, talking about the various different huge problems that you mentioned, when we cannot recognize the value of human dignity at its earliest time? Our country is in the middle of a turmoil with regards to extreme polarization on this topic. You have done such a wonderful job in your country in dialogue with your leaders. What do we do here? Thank you.
Question at a time. Yes, the idea of abortion came to my mind, but you see, you cannot put everything on the papers. I just say, for example, and I mentioned probably some of those crimes against humanity, which probably most of you will not be thinking about in the way I am looking at it. And that is precisely to challenge you to see some of those issues. But obviously, the abortion massacres in not only in this country, but in many countries, in the so-called advanced nations, is a crime against humanity. But you know very well the whole, basically, if you want to kill somebody, you try and make sure that you can convince yourself that he's not really a human being. So once you have decided that he's not a human being, then you can deal with him and kill him without disturbing your conscience. What surprised me, however, is that never before has it become so clear that the unborn child is a human being. In earlier days, before science reached the place it is now, there was still probably room to begin to doubt whether this small fetus is still a human being. But now we know, it is clear. And those people who approve abortion, I'm sure they won't agree that you can kill a child who is one day old. Okay, well, what's the difference then? Why kill the one in the womb and you don't want to kill the one outside? So there is issues to. I'm sure those must be the kind of people too who don't like the idea of human dignity. Once you can say that there is no such thing as human dignity, then you are not obliged to recognize it in anybody, not even in the unborn. You can exempt yourself from respecting the human dignity of anybody whom you think is against you. As you know, the same line of thought goes from abortion to euthanasia. People 95 years, 100 years old, people languishing away in homes, and people are saying we should just help kill them, let them kill them. And mercy killing, that's the word they use. You know. So it's a whole question of both philosophical and a theological attitude. What advice do I give you? No, just continue to say it now. Continue to insist on human dignity, and that this human dignity covers every human being, and then the unborn baby is a human being, and therefore is covered by your beautiful constitution, which says that every human being is self-evident. Your constitution says it very clearly, even if sometimes Supreme Court judges may not be too clear in their minds, but that's where we are.
By the way,
in my country, I will be the last to deny that there is abortion. Abortion is going on all over the place. People are going to all kinds of places to get abortion. Even doctors do carry out abortion, but it is still against the law. And if a doctor is found, is reported to the authorities as having provoked an abortion, he can go to jail and lose his license. That is the rule up till now. Of course, we are getting all kinds of wonderful missionaries coming, especially from this area. Missionaries coming to preach the gospel of abortion among our people and telling us that it is only backward nations that still do not approve abortion. It's an interesting argument. They said, you want your country to be progressive, to have the kind of beautiful world that they have here in America, do like the Americans do, have a law in abortion. And people begin to say, well, maybe that's why we are where we are, because we have not allowed it. But we continue to tell our people, especially because it's also against our culture, that we don't kill babies. We don't kill babies, even in our poverty. And many parts of the world, too, believe the same. Thank you.
I was thinking of, there's a scripture that says that they were not afraid to speak against dignitaries. And then when I see the word dignity, in America, we seem to have a different problem as far as this country was founded on kind of basically cursing King George. And so we have a problem, like when we look at a scripture that says, Jesus said, if you speak evil of your parents, you're to be put to death. So we don't respect, honor to those that are in authority. How do you address that aspect of human dignity, of giving honor to those in authority? We have a problem of students not respecting their teachers. We have a real problem that way. How do you look at it? How do you see that as far as addressing the end of human dignity? I mean, does that include the loss of respect for proper authority?
I'm not sure if I understand what you say, but even the law of God, which says honor your father and your mother, is still valid today. And I think any culture where the respect for parents is thrown overboard is likely to pay the price for it. Honor your father and your mother. You know, as for respect to authority, it depends on the authority. And the scriptures themselves give us very clear examples of where authority has been put in its place. St. Peter says it very clearly. Judge for yourself whether we should obey God or you. That's the authority of the chief priests. Or the whole story of the early church and the Roman Empire, where the Roman emperors had laws which wanted to force Christians to do things that are contrary to their conscience and to worship idols, to burn incense, and they refuse. And say, we are loyal citizens of Rome. Many of them are even soldiers who are putting their life on the line for the Empire of Rome, but we will not do anything that goes against our conscience and are ready to die for it. My feeling is that in many of these debates which border on conscience, we are so used to arguing things out and hoping that we can have a painless, easy agreement. But sometimes you reach a stage where you simply cannot have an agreement. You have to stand your ground and say no. And say no. We have, for example, in the United States, some doctors do suffer a lot of disability because they refuse to carry out abortions. You do very well to mount a strong case against it in all possible fora, but some people must be ready to stick their neck out and say, we are saying no, do whatever you like. Meaning that you pay with your own conviction, for your own conviction. Yeah. We pray that we don't have to live under a nation where you are ruled by people who are trying to force you against God's will. We pray we never, because normally the right thing is that the civil authorities should be doing God's will. But when it happens that they are not, we have to obey God rather than men. When do you reach that stage? It's not always easy, but everybody must make up his mind accordingly. Thank you. I don't know if I've answered your question. I wasn't too clear headed.
That was a good answer.
Yes, thank you.
Cardinal, thank you very much for your lecture. Since we're interested in the intellectual appeal of human dignity for theology, for the theological and philosophical imagination, I wonder if you might address that in the other direction, your thoughts on perhaps the importance of theological and philosophical education for restoring weight to the notion of human dignity. What role do you think that, especially in institutions such as ours, theology and philosophy might have in leading us forward here?
The only thing I can say now is that by the time I went to seminary and did philosophy and theology, the question you were raising was not there. Everybody agreed that there are basic human rights. Now that it is being challenged, even at the level of philosophy and theology, it means it becomes a matter to be tabled for discussion. But in the case for us who are Christians, Catholics, we have all our, we have the basic norms and the sources in our theology and in the scriptures, and even in the doctrine in the magisterium of the church, voluminous, copious magisterium of the church that arms you. If not to convince the other, definitely to let the other know that you know what you're talking about. Because sometimes there's nothing you will say that will convince certain people. But at least you can let them know that you may not agree with me, but I can let you know that my position is not unreasonable. That much we should do, and do with all our hearts. And the more they shout, the more we should shout too. That's the whole point of intellectual freedom. And so, by the way, I hear sometimes here that even the concept of international freedom, intellectual freedom, gets practically snuffed out here, because there are certain things you just don't say. It is politically not acceptable. And so even philosophers who are trying to make their point have to be careful about the things, kind of thing they will say. Even things which they deeply believe in, you can't say it. If you say it, you are considered as, you get a name. And again, I say, there are some people who should admit and ready to fight and ready to suffer for it. Luckily, in this country, I noticed there are a good number of universities that are coming up precisely to be available for people who want to defend Catholic positions and doctrines. I hope Notre Dame is one of them, where you can do it in an intellectually coherent way, such that you have no reason to have any kind of inferiority complex vis-a-vis somebody who may have a big name in another big university, but who do not share the basic elements of our faith. This is where the training of Catholic priests and theologians comes in, very important. That you have to, a priest should be well trained in these matters, he should be able to get up and say, and also the lay theologians, and today a good idea is the fact that we're having many lay theologians who can stand up and articulate our position, especially in areas of family life, sexual morality, and so on, where people like me, they will tell you don't know what you're talking about. But by the way, they are wrong. I know what I'm talking about.
Friends, maybe one more question.
Thank you, Eminence, for that wonderful talk. I teach philosophy here at the university, and I notice there's a kind of wonderful ambiguity in the title of the conference, which is The End of Human Dignity, and the ambiguity is in the term end. In English, end can mean the stop, like the end of the game when the time has run out, but it can also mean the goal or the point, like in Greek, the telos, or in Latin, the fini of dignity. And I think in philosophy, one of the reasons there's this sort of attack on the notion of human dignity is people do want to defend killing. If you look at bioethics, for instance, bioethics is essentially about managing the killing of human beings. And so the problem with the notion of dignity, when philosophers talk about it, and the reason they want it to stop in that sense of end, is that it's kind of a barrier to killing. But in that context, then it becomes a question, well, what's wrong with killing? And what we don't get is a discussion, and I wonder if you might have some thoughts on whether, at least with regard to the notion of the self-evidence, which you emphasized, the self-evidence of human dignity, still there might be more to be said about whether or not human dignity has a point or a goal to be achieved, so that it doesn't function within these philosophical discussions as a kind of way to just simply stop people from either killing, or if we can get rid of the notion of dignity, that prevents a barrier. I guess my point is that in philosophical discussions right now, human dignity functions as a sort of barrier against killing. But it doesn't seem as though there's much of a discussion of whether it has a richer, it's a richer notion about a point or a goal, and what that, if you have any thoughts on what the goal of human dignity might be.
I'm not a philosopher, but I try to reason also like every human being. Surely human dignity has a reason, a goal. Put it differently, that if we did away with human dignity, then we are in the jungle. If we did away with human dignity, on what basis will it be that I cannot infringe upon your right if I'm powerful enough to do so? We will be in the jungle where it will be the survival of the strongest and the fittest. You will not have a situation where you can say, please don't do this to me. Why? Why should I not do it to you if I can do it? So there must be a situation where no matter how strong and powerful you are, there is a limit to what you can do to another human being. The kind of limit that you don't have when you are dealing with your dog and you are tired of it. In which case, for me, you can put it differently too, and I mentioned it at the beginning of my paper. When you have a human truth that is widespread, both historically from ancient days until now, and geographically covering most human beings, and we all seem to agree about this, there must be something behind it. I would say behind it is, of course, that God has put it there. I don't know how you will explain it philosophically. After all, philosophy must be based on some basic principles, whether it is in logic or whatever. So I think I mentioned that some people have taken a position for ideological reasons or for selfish reasons, and there's nothing you can say that is going to change their mind. So they are not even waiting for philosophical arguments. But at least if we have a position that we think is valid not only for us, but for humanity. And one of the basic elements of Christian morality is that the will of God is what is best for human beings, that the law of God is best for human beings, that even the 10 commandments is put there for our sake. And the Jews, ancient Israel, were so grateful to God that they had been given wonderful laws and rules and regulations, because they see all this as an element that has made them superior to other nations, but also that has organized their lives very well. So you follow it. And I believe that is also the situation in any country. You want to have laws that work, that respect human beings and their needs. Whether you succeed or not is quite another matter. I was reading a little bit about the original Declaration of Independence of America. It was obvious that they have a whole range of common vision about certain things. Definitely, God kept coming up. Yes, it's about because God has done it. So if God has done it, then you can then have a philosophical conclusion from the fact that God has put it there. If you decide not to talk anymore about God, then the onus is upon you to find something else better. What is that something else better that you are going to give us now? I don't know. And I'm not looking for that, because in God I trust.
Thank you very much, Your Eminence.